When I was looking at my music library and polling my subscribers and followers on social media for killer three-part harmonies, Alice in Chains just kept coming up. So I decided to make a whole video about Alice in Chains' vocal harmonies. There were so many songs and albums to choose from, and I had to make some really tough decisions to make this video a reasonable length. So if I didn't get to a song that you love and you'd really want to hear my thoughts about, just leave a comment and we will keep the conversation going there. So most of us are fortunate enough to know the powerful and iconic voice of Layne Staley, and we associate his voice with the sound of Alice in Chains. And I in no way want to downplay his contribution because it really can't be overstated. But I gotta give credit where credit is due. Jerry Cantrell, who also sings vocals, would usually be harmonizing with Layne. He wrote almost all of the songs. First, I just wanna get a few technical terms out of the way so that you can follow along a little bit better. The distance between two notes is called an interval, and they have various names to describe how small or big they are. So like major third, minor second, perfect fifth. A chord is three or more notes, so it's basically intervals stacked on top of each other and nested within each other. I think the main reason why Alice in Chains harmonies stick out is the use of parallel fourths and fifths. There comes a time. Walk these streets are creeping apart. Oh yeah. I find master. Make you shake your blade. Parallel harmony just means that when one voice goes up or down, the other voice also goes up or down to preserve the same interval. Them Bones from their album Dirt has a great example of parallel fourths. Power chords that the guitar is playing, some really cool complex chords are created together. Oof. Yeah. All of those are amazing. I love them. And then, oh. During the chorus of Them Bones, Jerry is singing the melody and it's moving around a lot. And if Layne were to try to sing in any sort of parallel interval with him, it might sound a little busy or maybe it would have been too difficult. I don't know. But instead, we have some nice oblique motion, which simplifies the harmony and helps bring a little more attention to the melody. Oblique motion is when one voice stays the same while the other one moves down or up. I feel so alone. That's the melody. I feel so alone. And then Layne is harmonizing higher. I feel so alone. Layne is singing the seventh of these chords. That's not the simplest thing they could have done. It's also not the easiest thing, but it sounds amazing. If Layne just moved his harmony up a step, then he'd be singing in a major or minor chord. Actually, they're both major. So he'd be singing in the major chord and not adding a tense seventh. That sounds great. There's nothing wrong with that. But they took it a step further in complexity. Major seventh chord, dominant seventh chord. That has so much more emotional impact, him singing I Feel So Alone on those tense notes. The verse of Wood has an example of parallel fifths. Broken by my master. Teach me a child of your Jerry singing the melody. And Lane's harmonizing with him a fifth above that. So the reason I keep saying fourths and fifths is because the perfect fifth is an inversion of the perfect fourth, or vice versa. Parallel fourths and fifths have been discouraged by composers at various times in our Western musical history. I think they have their place. Essentially, what they sound like a lot of the time is an empty chord. One and five together create this perfect fifth, or perfect fourth. We're basically missing the third. Without the third, this is essentially an ambiguous chord. It doesn't have the third to tell us if it's major or minor. It could be either. You could argue that the third gives the chord its primary emotional property. So an open fifth or fourth has a bit of a raw, kind of unforgiving and non-committal sound. It also resonates differently in instruments and voices than, say, a third or a sixth. There's a lot of texture and almost acoustic beating that you can hear between a fifth and a fourth, especially. Whoa, did you hear that one? So with full textured voices like Lane's and Jerry's, when they harmonize together, especially in fourths, you can feel it resonating. It's all right, there comes a time. And you might think, after hearing all of these examples, that parallel fourths and fifths are commonplace in rock music. And certainly there are other bands that do it, but much, much more common is parallel thirds in vocal harmonies. Sand rains down in here, I sit, holding red flowers. As I was saying before, thirds often reveal the major or minor quality of the chord. It's not always, but usually. If fifths are like a blank canvas, adding the third is like putting color on it. Also, these voices are closer together than fourths or fifths, and so they tend to sound kind of linked up. They have a similar timbre, and they sound very supportive of each other, kind of like two friends walking down the street arm in arm, versus other intervals that are much bigger and wider can feel like two friends walking down the street on opposite sides. I say these analogies because we are affected by music emotionally, and it's not just because of the lyrics. Thirds are close. They're like a hug. Holding red flowers. The vocals come in on parallel thirds. The guitar comes in right before it, singing in parallel thirds too. It feels like the guitar is singing. That's why I said that. This is in G sharp, and then sometimes C sharp. But either way, it's using a scale called Dorian, which is like the minor scale, but with one note raised up. You can practically hear Lane descending that scale. Lane is singing the melody. And Jerry is harmonizing in thirds below him. That's actually not parallel thirds all the way down. There's a moment where Jerry kind of starts to move down more than Lane is moving down. But it's kind of hard to hear, and it feels like Jerry's voice is actually getting buried softly underneath Lane's, and it sort of just disappears. He could have harmonized a third above Lane, but I think this would have really blatantly revealed the raised sixth in this scale, and that's a pretty powerful spice to cook with, and I don't think they want to hit you over the head with it too soon because it's so potent. They use it very carefully to create an emotional pull, and so if you give everybody what they want right away, it can kind of dilute that power. It would sound like this. Softly in this world. it seems almost a little hopeful, and it's pulling focus away from the sadness of this melody, which starts on the minor third. Resolving to the tonic, this finality feeling. Sand rains down in here, I sit. That's so beautiful. It's kind of literal, right? Sand rains down. So this descending line in harmony with almost a little bit of a pained seventh. See that tension? The chorus is in C sharp Dorian. So if you ever felt a shift when they go up to down in a hole, it's probably because it's in a different key. When they lean on that one, that's tense. I'd like to fly. I'd like to fly. They chose to continue with parallel thirds when the more obvious choice would be to use something called oblique motion, where the upper voice, which I think is Lane, stays the same, and Jerry would move down. So the intervals would go from a third to a fourth. I'd like to fly. Like that. And you know, and that would keep his voice up too on fly. I love how he goes down and creates a dominant seventh chord. And dominant seventh chords have within them a diminished chord, which sounds very unstable, like that. He'd like to fly, but he can't. You know, he falls down. He's being pulled down by the melody. Oh, the three-part harmonies in Down in a Hole just kill me. They bury me softly in this world. I don't know about you, but I feel things when I hear three-part harmony. Growing up singing choral music and folk music and Christmas music, but it's not as common in rock. So it's just so cool to hear it really beautifully integrated into this genre. And I mean the umbrella of rock. And just to be clear, when I say three-part harmony, I'm talking about three different voices singing different notes. Oh, I wanna be inside of you. That just feels like such a desperate and vulnerable plea for connection. So there's two outside voices and then an inner voice. This would mean that either Lane and or Jerry are going to be overdubbing, right? They're going to be tracking another third vocal. So this part, I'm not exactly sure which one's the melody, and I often will sing whichever one I'm feeling at the moment. But the bottom one goes, oh, I wanna be inside of you. The next voice up, oh, I wanna be inside of you. Together. I mean, it's exquisite as is, but then then they add a third voice on top.
Oh, it's so good.
By adding that upper voice, they're doing two things. One, they create the richness of three voices resonating together. That has a slightly different sound to it than just two voices. The other thing, though, that they're doing is that they are creating seventh and ninth chords with the bass line and what the guitar is doing as well. So the voices by themselves are just major and minor triads. Okay. But they are part of a bigger chord. The chord starts on G sharp. This next chord starts on F sharp. And then this chord actually starts all the way down on C sharp. Shit. This is a seventh chord. This is also a seventh chord. And then this is a ninth chord. That's the wrong one, but that is really beautiful. Just hearing that start off with this tension. Also, most people will tend to pick out the highest note they're hearing. And in this case, that's Lane singing the tensest part of the chord. And this feels like resolution that's leading us towards tension. That is a cool feeling. In Rooster, we hear parallel thirds in the intro, and it's sung in, I think, Lane's falsetto. These thirds are giving us a lot of chord information and emotional information. But we get this almost bluesy, kind of mournful sounding dominant seventh chord, F. When they play this live, they tend to choose an inversion of this third. Sometimes Lane sings up here, while Jerry sings a tenth below him. Other times, Lane sings this part while Jerry sings the higher part, but an octave lower. My guess is this was just because Jerry maybe doesn't have the high range that Lane did, and so Lane was maybe overdubbing himself in the recording, and so when they did it live, Jerry had to choose a much lower part. But this would be an example of revoicing a harmony.
Yeah, they come to snuff the rooster.
This is really cool because I think Jerry did something a little bit more creative here and created more tension in the process. It's basically not the most obvious choice that someone could have made in harmonizing this line.
Yeah, they come to snuff the rooster.
Look at that, parallel fifths. Starting with this nice major third, but then Jerry starts encroaching on Lane, who is just staying here. This is that oblique motion. And he gets so close that he's only a whole step away from Lane. And in the same register, an octave too. So literally, and that's a very tense interval. And it's very close for two voices to be. I love this choice. And he keeps bringing us to this tension and then releasing it with this little back and forth.
Yeah, they come to snuff the rooster.
Then we have those parallel fifths. What makes those parallel fifths sound so cool, though, is really the chord underneath played by the bass, and the guitar. So we have... So this is basically a seventh chord, missing the fifth, but you don't necessarily need it to imply it. So that's a very tense place to leave us. It's really kind of, it's a bit more peaceful, though, than I think where they leave us on the second repetition, which is a sus2 chord. Yeah, like a hug, right? Here come the rooster. Wide open, less forgiving, not a hug anymore. So it has this, like, bravado to it. Also, the chord underneath. This is called a sus2 chord. It's like two stacked fifths. It's tense, it's wide, it's not stable. But it's also kind of, like, strong. It's bold. Also, the first time Lane went, rooster, he kind of took away a little of the power there. Rooster. Now he goes, rooster. Yeah. And you can feel this so badly wanting to go up. Rooster. Yeah. And it does, resolving to the tonal center of the song. The reason I wanted to point out this song and its parallel third action is because there's something called mode mixture happening in the chords. And so in the harmonies, they kind of have to take that into account. When you do things like this, it creates chromaticism. And the thirds are revealing that drama. So take a listen. Like the coldest winter chill. Not exactly easy to do. Much respect. Like when. Major third, minor third. You hear that? Now, during this part, there's actually a third voice. So this is technically three-part harmony, but those parallel thirds are the thing that always stuck in my head over these years. So that's why I kind of wanted to analyze it this way. But if you listen more closely, you can actually hear. Like the coldest. Right there. All the way up. Coldest winter chill. And then that higher voice suddenly gets a lot louder. Heaven beside you. Heaven beside you. If they decided to build it out into three-part harmony, they would add a voice underneath and it would go like this. You don't always need three notes to make something sound like a chord or imply a chord. This is also a good example of how to use vocal harmonies in very specific moments. Instead of having it be the sound of the song, they're used very conservatively to highlight a moment, a musical moment or a lyrical moment. So they're just singing down a chord, basically. Both of them are going down, but they are going down by different intervals. So first we have a fourth, then a third, then another third, and then a fourth again. And then the harmony is abandoned when they say, "Save me," and he's left alone. Both go down, third, fourth. They could have done parallel thirds. Wow, so different. When Lane's singing by himself without the harmony, just an octave, then Jesus Christ. And that line brings a little bit more, I think, vulnerability. This is very stoic sounding. But then they take it one step further when Jerry joins in on He Who Tries, bringing in this third. Hey. Okay. That creates this full sound of a minor chord.
Hey, yay.
But then,
yay, yay, yay.
On that note, it becomes tense again.
Hey, yay, yay, yay.
Listen to that. Then they join kind of in unison, I think, on tries. And then Jerry leaves and Lane finishes the line by himself in a lower part of the scale.
Fear in my eyes.
It's your decision.
This is Jerry singing the melody and William Duvall singing the harmony. The first time Jerry sings a melody, it's actually naked. So there's no vocal harmony on it. And then on the second line, William comes in. And you can really appreciate in real time just how much that vocal harmony adds.
It's your decision. It's your decision.
Really drives home that feeling of the resignation in this statement. It's your decision. So Jerry,
your decision.
William,
it's your decision.
Starting with some parallel fourths, ending on a third. And it's because they're following chords. Those two, E flat major, D flat major. Doesn't end there though, because we have, there's a nice little back and forth here. And then, I love this. William goes just a little bit below where he's targeting it, essentially. Like a scoop almost. That's just a nice stylistic choice. The vocal harmonies in the verse are really, really nice too.
Overwhelmed, you chose to run. Apathetic to the stunt.
Overwhelmed, you chose to run.
What I like about that is that, once again, it's not the most obvious choice. That's probably the simplest way to harmonize that line.
Overwhelm.
That is cool.
Overwhelm, you chose.
That, I think, is an interesting choice. It would make more sense for them to stay here on E flat.
Overwhelm, you chose to run.
Like that. But what they did here is decided to bring in this third. Again, these are conscious choices, especially that one. That one is not the most intuitive, I think.
Overwhelmed, you chose to run.
Overwhelmed, you chose.
But it adds a very interesting fragility to that moment.
Got no patience to search for peace of mind.
Now, this is an awesome example of that oblique motion I was talking about, how cool it can sound to have that consistent tone that is kind of grounding us and orienting us while the other voice is sort of moving away from it, towards it, almost like against it. Like I said before, kind of encroaching upon it, closer and closer and closer, building tension as it does.
Da-da-da.
Oh, I love that moment so much. Lane is just staying on B flat, and Jerry is moving closer and closer to him. The second repetition is a little bit different, and it's super cool because Jerry is basically very gracefully handling what's called mode mixture.
No more hiding, all the skies and truths are told.
This is just so brilliant.
Skies into the soul.
And then it turns minor again right at the end. So it starts minor.
Mm-hmm.
and then resolved major, and then back down. Because the next chord is a flat six chord. And this note doesn't belong in that chord. All right, folks, closing out this video is possibly the dankest? I don't normally say this word, but I cannot think of a better one to describe the three-part harmony in I Stay Away. It is the dankest. In fact, it's probably some of the dankest three-part harmony in all of rock. So what we actually have here are parallel major chords. When I sing along with this in the car, I kind of just pick whichever voice feels the most conflicting at the time. Any other car singers out there? Car harmonizers? Carmonizers. It is so cool to hear three-part harmony sound threatening. And some of that can be owed to the chromaticism, but some of that can also be owed to Lane's textured voice. It sounds so harsh here. Why you act crazy, not an act, baby. Why you act frightened, I am. In your weakness builds me so. Someday you'll see. All right, guys, that's the end of this video. If there are other bands that have legendary three-part harmony, or actually, you know what, just vocal harmonies in general, please leave a comment. I'm definitely interested in doing more videos on vocal harmonies. If you want to support my channel and you want to hear my thoughts on songs you love, you might want to consider checking out my Patreon. This and teaching is my full-time job, so any support you can give is much appreciated. If you can't contribute that way, no worries. Just like the video, turn on the notification bell, subscribe before that, share the video. You know, thanks y'all. Have a good one. Until next time. Oops. So we have two outside voices. Oh no, I'm not gonna do that. Want to travel south this year. How am I gonna get through this without crying? I don't know. I don't think I'm gonna be able to do it. Either Jane and or Jerry. This means that either Jane and Larry.